And I am going to do this by starting with recent stuff that I happen to know, I'm sitting here for an hour, that you might want to hear just as follow-ups to things you've talked about, and push on into upcoming things a little bit to a lot of the attitude adjustment of upcoming things. So that URL actually exists. There's lots of links on it. You can type it in. I'm going to click off of that into another one that's got local edits, so I don't have to go remote so much. So this is entirely driven by you. Except I'm going to start with stamp block and see where it goes.
You can erase everything. It's fine.
So you guys talked about atomics, and you talked about concurrent collections, and you talked about rewrite locks, and you know there's this whole sphere of I have stuff that's mostly read, sometimes written. I need it to be thread safe. What do I do? And usually the first thing you do is you see if there is some custom collection or synchronization mechanism already there that somebody has figured out the best way to do it. So concurrent hash maps is the main success story. There is not a concurrent program in the world that does not use a concurrent hash map somewhere. It's just like an obvious thing to do. As Danny said, it's by far the most widely used WTO concurrent component by a landslide. It is enormously complex inside for reasons I'll talk a little bit about. Often you have something where you say, well, I have this existing thing, it's mostly read, and I'd I don't want to make a custom version of it, but at least I can slap a read write block around it. And I gather you guys saw that that is like a big loop. Why is that? Why that is that if you have a very busy concurrent collection, even if it's read mostly, there is a huge amount of contention going on just to do the bookkeeping. We have a whole bunch of readers, and all they want to do is to say, hey, I'm here, and I'm a reader. Just saying, hey, I'm here, and I'm a reader, is a very costly thing to do when there are lots of them running on lots of cores with lots of cache contention just to get to the cache line holding that thing you want to say, hey, I'm here. So this is some classic scalability problems that we cover and hopefully solve well enough for a living. This is what we do. We build these things so that hopefully these solutions, we put a lot of effort into them and you don't have to do them. So we're going to find, down in the next part, there's actually some pretty cool ways of dealing with this if you're willing to give up atomicity. So people have been doing rewrite locks for a while. It's a problem no matter what rewrite lock you use. Here's a different strategy. How about we allow people to do optimistic reads? That is, let me read it. Let me check if it changed while I was reading it. If it didn't, yay, I'm done. Nobody saw me coming, nobody saw me going. I was very quiet. I am extremely high scalability. Don't wander too far away. These are just props. I just threw these things together. The hope is to engage you a little bit. get you thinking about what we think about all the time. So optimistic locks, really a common way of doing things. Most databases use some sort of optimistic locking. They don't do it as efficiently as you can if you make a custom lock, which is built so that you can do, try to do an optimistic read. If I fail, then get a regular read lock. And if I need to upgrade to a write, I can upgrade to a write, or maybe a Dart as a write to begin with. And everything works. Sounds like a good idea. The idea of having readers that are strictly bargeable, breakable, is something that's been used in systems programming for a long time. Clocks are C-clock. Linux uses C-clocks a lot. If you are building these so that you have a path across these three modes, the big challenge is what happens across these modes. That's the main problem stamp lock actually deals with. It's a little hard to imagine until you see it in practice that reader starvation and writer starvation, they're real things. You can have a read-write lock where all the readers are going fast until the writer comes in and then they all stop and they never recover because the writers all just hog the lock, and vice versa. So people have actually worked on this for decades, and we use and contribute in the form of a so-called phase pair, where you lock logically just alternates between read and write mode whenever it can. Try and lock and say, no, I want to read on the center. So that's stamp lock. It's a lock. It's not a read-write lock. You can get a read-write lock view out of it. Here it is a little bit in practice. We try to make our APIs into slideware. So here's a little example of that. Action. It's just a dumb point class because who cares what you're reading and writing? We're reading and writing points because they have two fields and two is the smallest number you can demonstrate with a lock. So as a write lock, note that all these methods, they hand you back stamps. The stamps are the key of doing these validations, upgrades, downgrades, conversions. You're handed back a cookie, and you have to provide us with this cookie whenever you want to do anything. So you say, write lock, unlock it. You gotta tell us what to do. That means they're intrinsically not reentrant. You have a call from your thread and to another method that calls that again, and you didn't hand the stamp.
Yep.
Well, it's broken. Fine. So here's sort of the canonical good way of doing a read here. So this is something just gets the distance from origin. And it says, try optimistic read. It returns zero if it fails. We don't even want to check the value though. Say, hey, maybe we've got a zero. We don't care, we're just going to go through it. Try to read it, validate. If you got back zero the first time, well, it never validates. If somebody wrote while you were holding this, then validate returns false. Then you say, oh, okay, I'm going to upgrade to a read lock. Try it again. This time I know I won't fail. Now we have just gotten some very large speed up factor in our read code. I'll show that other people have made. I tried as hard much as I could to only present performance data other people collect. We are happiest when other people see good results. We can manufacture, anybody can manufacture good results. When we have real users doing it, we're pretty pleased. So that's a happy starter stamp book. It's got a bunch of methods. You get a feel that look familiar, but they all are different from the normal reentrant lock and reentrant read-write lock in that they return stamps. You get to control. It means that you have to think a little bit differently about how you use locked regions, but it gives you really simple optimistic concurrency. Optimistic concurrency has this rep as it's fast, but it's scary. We give you something that it's a little tiny ramp up, just a slightly different API, and now you can do a lot of optimistic stuff. Whenever you think, well, maybe I'll try something optimistically and then fall back, you have a good handle on it. Here's some of the this is data from Heinz Kibbutz. Anyone who knows who he is, he's a trainer in Java, living in Crete, and does professional consulting and is the world's greatest stamp locker. So trying to push these things as hard as could, saying, well, how often, even in a really busy system, how often do you have to fall back on pessimistic locks? Your mileage varies, but be optimistic about optimism. You know, if you try to read something that's going to take you a week to read, well, you know, you're not going to validate. But if you remember that a context switch, we'll get to this later, context switch these days, how many cycles is a context switch?
8,000.
The answer is, the variance on this answer is so huge that quoting anything would be wrong. In these days of power management, core fusion, OS, affinities, and the like, when a thread goes to sleep, it could take a long time to wake up, maybe a million cycles. Or it could be instantaneous, you know, register. Huge variance, six order of magnitude variance on a context switch these days. That's the life you live. Six orders of magnitude variance. Blocking, good or bad? Bad because it's unpredictable. Not because it's slow, it's because it's unpredictably slow. All right. This is no concurrency, just raw overhead. Yeah, we actually have better overhead than pretty much all locks because we get a little smarter now. We just do the bare uncontended cases. Here's where you get maybe I should take this seriously. 353x performance improvement. Really? 353 times faster. This is a great thing about working in concurrency. We never see 10% differences. We see, you know, the smallest interesting difference is a factor of 2. This is a fun thing. Even trying our very best with the end of the block, there are these starvation cases where things like the multiple blocking mixed with some unfortunate garbage generation in some cases will lead you to a case where nobody's hardly moving. Why? Because a thread wakes up, can do almost nothing, goes back to sleep. Right? So it can do over and over again. And step lock, the phase pair stuff was the main advance in this lock.
Step locks in Java range?
Yes. Yes. Yeah. If you're not using Java 8,
you should.
Then I refuse to talk. All right, so that's the story about stand blocks. Even more boring looking, adders. What can be more boring than counting and adding numbers? Any candidates? I can't think of any. Long adder solves the problem of, this is the most important picture of the day, solves the problem of, I got zillions of threads all trying to increment a counter, or add, find the next one. We'll use increment, because it's probably thinking anyway. And I guess you guys did some experiment with it. You find that, if you use a lock, well, it's locked. If you use an atomic, it starts scaling pretty well, and then it just can't go any higher and starts going lower. And you start throwing lots and lots and lots of cores because you are doing worse than the memory system rate of moving cache lines across. So what do you want to do about that? We want to make it better, because counting things is a really common thing to do. Like, an extremely common thing to do. A lot of what you do in a lot of web infrastructure is count things. So we would like to make that really fast, and we're going to give up atoms. Here's the sleazy trick. Okay. Whenever we see there's a lot of contention here, we're going to take this one variable and we're going to split it into two. So we add one here, and you want to know the answer. Well, the answer is no longer atomic, because to get the answer, we've got to run through these and add them up. And while we're adding them up, one of them's going to change. So two, and this guy, well, by that time it's already. And worse, there may not be a point of time at which point that answer was ever right. Somebody can increment, somebody can decrement. While we scan through, it all comes to a wash. We give you a number that was never true. Yeah. Now, the notion is you only want to read it either heuristically or at acquiescently. I know a bunch of stuff. You only want to know the answer when it's all done. Because why else would you be? Well, maybe you're counting things to maintain a semaphore or something like that. Well, don't use this. But if you're using a count to count things, a lot of things, then long adder is made for you. It's a lot of really fun, not blocking atomic tricks. There's an underlying Stripe 64. The basic idea is everybody starts up here. So a Stripe 64 has a base counter and a possibly null pointer to an array of the backup slots. And whenever you collide, say, don't use this guy anymore. Start using the backup slots. Use something you can see.
Yes.
You know, it doesn't matter if I can see it. I just need to point to it. This is the problem. And then we, of course, I'm a sort of a druid free, so that's the root. And then these can further subdivide. But they don't really subdivide in trees. We just use, we double an array every time. The second thing we do is, this is fairly small. This is 164-bit long and one pointer and another control bit, it turns out. When we expand out, we actually, this is an array of objects. Each of the objects is a padded cell. A padded cell has one 64-bit value that we actually care about, and a whole bunch of cache blind padding, so we're sure it doesn't conflict with anything else we could be doing.
Yeah.
If you don't do that, long adder is not so good.
Because of false sharing, probably.
Yeah, it's false sharing with a vengeance. The main reason is,
how does that work when you're on different hardware?
Say that again.
For the padded cell, so it's going to fit the cache line?
Yeah, we
cache lines are different sizes depending on what hardware you're running on.
Yeah, so that used to be mysterious. It's still mysterious, but we listed it on the JVM. So there's something called sun.mist.contended. It's an annotation. Shove it as annotation in front of any class that you believe the instances will be subject to fit while sharing. It is only manual right now. You have to know to use it. And in their infinite wisdom, the OpenJDK folks said, you know, we're going to do this because I just like ranted and raved and said I was going to split my wrists and tell you if I did it. And I said, okay, we'll do it, but we won't even make it a public API. It's citing there in the sun.misc territory. Sun.misc is a package that your portable code is not supposed to use. And to be even more evil, because it's an annotation, they can't make it illegal, so they just ignore it if you're not inside a JDK package. So I can use it all at once. And we use it only a few times. We use it very selectively. Five times in all of Java utils in terms. More than 100k ones in terms by a lot. Do that, and we get really good performance. Fun algorithmic tricks, you say, well, keep doubling and doubling. Well, how much can you double? Maybe you have thousands of threads. Well, at some point you say, well, I have enough slots for all my cores, if not all my threads. So at some point you say, let's try flipping your hash locator around and try to find the optimum so that uses no more slots than you have CPUs. So we found this to say we will never have any more slots than you have cores. Otherwise, it's no better than using thread locals, and the big problem locals is you have an unbounded number of threads and you have to like keep track of who they are, just count through them. This says, we don't care about your threads, we'll do a mapping from core, pseudo mapping from core, we use your thread ID, we cache it. Results are really good. Let's get somebody else. Just a quad core. We test everything on very NUMA-ish, the most NUMA-ish boxes that Intel will give me. So I normally test everything on 4 sockets, Xeon 64 total cores, something like that. So this is just a quad core. And this is something that you did, most of you here, already, right? This is synchronized. Wow, don't do that. Atomic, on this box, it never started going down. On a lot of boxes, it will. you live with error. Well, living with error and using long adder, they're not different enough. You might as well just always use it. You never live with error. You live with lack of atomicity. So you can make mistakes. You can make conceptual mistakes, saying, oh, the count is three. When it hits three, I fire the missiles. Well, don't use a long adder for that. Because the value three could be a lie.
But it's only a lie at that point in time. It will eventually be corrected, if I think so.
Yeah, it's a so-called obstruction-free result. That is, if nobody else is changing, then you will get the right answer. Right, so this is, you get a feel for what we are, where we head in WTOP current is find the bottommost layer of what people need and try to do that. We don't build the cool frameworks on top of it. You do, hopefully. We build the stuff that allows you to build the cool frameworks. And this is a little thing that was, you know, a big chunk of my life. The code for it. I won't show most of it, but this is just a bit. It's not. Here's all the little padded boxes, the hashing. This is the kind of code that sits under it. This is a code that triggers on CAS failure. You tried to do an update, and you collided. Your CAS failed. That means somebody's trying to hurt you. You fall into this that tries to do the best thing of move your position, add a cell, expand the array, or if nothing else looks good, well, we have that base pointer up there, base count. Just fall back to it if you have to. So it just sprawls a long time. And so, okay. Along these same lines, so. Building in fundamental things. Splittable random. Guy Steele and I worked on. Guy is actually going to present a paper on it at the conference. I think it's Thursday. He's presenting. Here's the idea. You were told, I hope Danny said, never share a Java util random among different threads, right?
Yeah.
It was
the first lab on Friday afternoon.
Oh my God.
They did it, and we had to fix it.
Excellent. And you used splittable random.
They didn't show us that.
Splittable random is designed in the same way a lot of the Java 8 parallel stuff is designed for fork join-ish bulk operations, split tasks, and so on. And so it's made to be used in anything where you would have structured parallelism where you could have some control. If you're doing unstructured concurrency, then there's still thread local random, which happens to use the same algorithm, but it's not quite as pretty. It's a really simple idea that it's bulk random, has the next method, like every random does, so has next long and next again, next load and so on. It also has next splittable random, which is called split. Hand me a new one, and I'll use it for my subtask. And the big challenge was, can you do that and still preserve high quality random properties? That took 20 pages for 20 lines of code to show that this strategy can be made to work, and can be made to work such that floatable random is actually faster than plain old random. Even if you remove the synchronization of plain old random, at least for 64-bit, for next long and next double, it's a little slower for next bit. So we actually made something that is faster and encourages you not to write stupid code, which is a really important thing. I hear you guys have like these posts, what's the hardest thing? We just think about, don't tempt people to do things that are wrong. Part of the problem is we evolve and there are new problems emerge, and sometimes there's things in WTO concurrent where that I hope people don't use anymore because we have better things, ways to do it. But we would never have known that or unless we had a whole generation of use of the initial versions. I know our discussion about thread pools is a good example. I think you should just always use four templates. They scale better than all the other kinds of executors. They will not starve you when you forget that you may be blocking a thread that you didn't intend to. And they are just so micro optimized because we have Amdahl's law to cope with when we're doing work time parallelism. Every cycle of overhead we encounter trying to split a task, multiply that by 64 if you're on a 64 way. All the upfront overhead is just so did you talk about JDK parallel streams?
Yes.
Okay, good.
Yeah, ask. So this was the comment that guy had about the parallel streams in JDK 8 are the least or the most idiom proof of all the idiot proof of all the. So we talked about four joint tasks, parallel threads, executors, thread pools. And,
right. It's my first chance to go out of order, so I'm going to take it.
Yeah.
I was hoping for chaos, and you guys have not pushed me into chaos yet. A couple of things we did in JDK 4.1. One is we put in support for an API that we had very consciously decided not to put out in the initial version, and that is a completion form of says when I complete and when my two subtasks complete, continue it by combining them in this way. So rather than do fork stuff, join, do stuff, you say you built into it what to do upon the join. And now that is a completion or a continuation that is passed into the executor. Much more flexibility. Really, really, maybe you're reading this, much less pleasant to program. And I mean it. Completions have this bad rep, a deserved bad rep. Sort of ugly to do this. You have to stack rip, as they say, and take the logical flow of control and turn it into the smallest possible units of execution, and then somehow put them together. I actually love that. I would do that all day long if they let me.
Same thing as Node.js callbacks.
Oh, you want it? Let's yes, absolutely. Oh, I like this. We're now three levels deep. Remember where we are. Yeah, so this used to be this really terrible problem, is that even the simplest kinds of continuation completion programs, which we know especially with I/O, aren't absolutely always the best thing to do. People hate to do it. Then the world changed a little bit. And the way the world changed a little bit is that people found out that if you can combine function objects and fluent APIs, you can make something that people like to program. A lot of people discovered this almost all at once. Scala people, I think deserve the credit for like the initial inspiration here. The Node.js people were not far behind. They said, you know, how about we just do node blocking? Who knows what Node.js is? It's JavaScript where there's only a single event thread, so it's not even really multi-threaded, but you still have to use continuation paths and completions because there are literally no blocking calls, no blocking I/O whatsoever, because it's JavaScript getting over to the server side, so really you can't block. People have been doing things like this for a while. Listenable features in Guava. We were very, very, very sad. I was very, very, very sad that I've been wanting to do some sort of flow-based API since the initial JDK 5 release. Java was very hostile to that. No function types, no lambdas. You can't say what you would like to inject in any reasonable way without minimal language support. So you might get a sense that I was probably the most adamant person affiliated with anybody working in core Java about, you know, I neither love nor hate functional programming, but really, I need functions if people are going to write concurrent programs in the future. So so that was actually one of the main factors for JDK 8, getting function support, was really not really like all the Haskell people get their way. It's because you cannot do fluent advanced. So Completable Future is the first hand in that ring. Completable Future is a kind of promise. It's, let's show you other people's examples. Completable Future is a future. Oh, you get a free ad. With that is fluently composable. So what that means is that you can have Completable Future dot supply async something, then accept, then apply, etc. We take this very seriously because we do concurrency. We say, if we're going to do this, we are going to make this computationally complete. That is, you can have these fluent things. And really, don't look at the signature. Look at the example. Examples. I'm going to have these. I'm really happy when other people measure, apply, use the stuff, and write blogs on it. I just make it, right? And, you know, I'm just an academic. Okay. So there's these then things. You can say, do something async, then do something else. There's then apply, then accept, then run. They're actually, the API itself is a little bit on the big side, because in Java, there's a big difference between void and everything else. So accept and apply differ by, is the thing you call a function or is it a procedure? Does it return something or not? And does it take an argument or not for run versus accept? So we have those. The compose version allows you to do flattening. It says you can have a bunch of things, each of which return a completable feature, flatten them all together into a set of completable features rather than a set of box completable features. We have ands and ors, so you can say, do these things async? When they're both complete, do this. We have ors, so you can say, do this, supply this async, start a timer, whichever comes first, do the completion. It's a style of programming that that you either say, where have you been hiding all my life? I love this to death. Or you say, I think I could get used to it. Almost nobody has any other further reaction. If you want to do insanely complicated things using continuations and completions, we give you only sort of limited syntax, which is sort of for your own good. This whole fluent dot thing only allows you to get so just a little bit crazy in terms of control flow. Really excellent, because when you have complicated control flow on top of complicated concurrency, good luck. So completable feature, it's been there. It's my vote for the sleeper award of JDK 8. The enterprise people are just starting to discover it, and you will see Java EE 8 with taking ideas of promises and completable features and turning them into something that the people who do enterprise Java. And the really telling issue is, you know, if Node.js people can cope with this, well, you can do better than that. So, completable features, I have been waiting a decade to put this in. So it's my favorite thing in JDK. And you will see examples of like, anyway, so we do that. And we say, well, okay, we have kind of completers, which are completable futures, which are great for dealing with I/O and timers and things like that. What if you're doing purely structured Java parallel stream operations, where you're doing basically map, reduce, filter, reach? Can you do that in a completion style, and why would you? Yes, you can do it in completion. Style. And the notion is a counter completer is something that has an onComplete action that is triggered when a counter goes to zero. So you can now have the essence of a phaser or cyclic barrier doing the counting for you. When all this is done, do the completion and a record of what to do. So a counter completer is a countdown latch and a delegate function call rolled into one. It turns out you can write faster Fortran code doing that if you don't know what people are doing in their leaf actions. The scary part about Java parallel streams to me, and the reason I pushed this through when it came up, is that people can put any old lambda in their map, reduce, filter, whatever. And what if it's something that would cause all of your worker threads to be dependent all on one of them that is blocked, and now you have this slow count to infinity problem is you have that, you fire up a new thread to prevent from starving, and the user makes it dependent on everything else too, and so you start up another one off to infinity. Users are not amused when you tell them that they are getting out of memory errors because they just happen to put synchronize in a completely crazy place in their code. And it's not hard to do that. So with completion mechanics, we can prevent that by only stalling the things that are actually blocked. Everybody else's, all the other workers are free to go and do something else because they are not blocked waiting. When that completion event occurs, the rest will fire and restart a whole bunch of other actions probably. So we could do that and not have to cope with naive and or hostile, and if you're Java people, the hostile case worries you a lot. Naive or hostile performance attacks on a parallel execution facility, since it's now anybody can say my array list dot parallel stream dot something. We sort of had to do this. Even at that, the thread throttling mechanisms we are putting, they'll be updated in the next JDK 8 update because there are people working in enterprise Java and security who worry that about the fact that you can very deviously still get a count to infinity thread problem. So we are smarter about it, and we put a hard cap on it. So as of JDK 8U4, if you generate more than 256 bare compensation threads, you die.
Yeah.
And you're dead. Sorry. Better than the alternatives. I have a great life. I invent algorithms. And 4 years later, they're on a billion computers. But you pay the price, and they're on a billion computers, and people do weird stuff. So there's an awful lot of embracing reality, not accommodating reality, a lot of embracing. People do weird stuff. I mentioned the concurrent hash map. Danny mentioned that concurrent hash map had some improvements. We finally could put in computed maps in, another thing. We're just waiting for language support. We also found a way to remove all segmentation, so basically every bit is its own segment, and that allows concurrent resizing. But the other thing that happened, the really traumatic event, is that a year or so ago, some bad guys out there discovered that they could bring down web servers by creating URLs or cookies that the web servers were keeping that all hash to the same hash code. So now you have a hash table that has an order of n lookup. It brings web servers to their knees because, remember I said there isn't a program that doesn't use a concurrent hash map?
Yeah.
They all do. And so every runtime, every platform in the world encountered this problem. Different people try different things. The Perl Python people said, oh, let's just use a new string hashing algorithm that is more previous to attack. And that's sort of the escalation strategy that then resulted. The bad guy said, oh, okay, we like a challenge, we'll find a way to do that. And okay, they're actually fine for probably 5 years doing that. Java started to do that too. In fact, there was a Java JDK 7 U release that said, we are changing we're putting these random solves in our string hash codes, just so to keep going. And I vehemently objected. I said, you know, let's fight algorithm with algorithm. So what concurrent hash map now does is that if you have colliding keys, inside of it, it has a balanced tree for the case where it will do comparative-based orderings if your key is comparable and all of them are tied. So concurrent hash map is now over 6,000 lines of code because embedded inside of it is an entire very special case balanced tree algorithm that works concurrently. So most of the really cool algorithmics are completely under the hood.
Yep.
They're there because they have to be there. They're there because they result in vastly better software. It's hard to appreciate in terms of wow factors of hey that's a cool thing, but it's a cool thing. We now have something where the very worst case number of iterations to find a key in a hash map is bounded by about 100. 97 point something. You run out of address space after that. So it's a balanced tree with 2 log n factor. So you cannot bring it down. That's what we do too, besides inventing like patently cool stuff. We invent stuff that was a little harder to. All right, so popping back out of all that, said, well, we could do this JDK stream stuff, for which I had not too much to do with the parallel stream per se, Brian Getz and Paul Sandoz, but that I mostly did the underlying WSL concurrent support to do it, and wrote pages and pages and pages of Java doc for these mysterious counter completers that has a recipe of how to do each and every one of the things that WSL stream parallel does. So if you want to know what goes on under the hood for Java parallel streams, look at the Java doc for counter completer. It has the idiomatic strategies for all of the common things that are done. Between that and there are some special cases. So we have I didn't do the parallel streams, but I implemented the parallel sort, which is a version of Silk Sort that uses counter completers, and the parallel prefix operation, sum in place, that if you have it, makes a bunch of parallel algorithms much easier to write. It's one of those, parallel prefix is one of those things that you don't know, you never know you need it until you used it. I'm not a good at that. Parallel prefix allows you to do something, sort of magic. Parallel prefix is, array of numbers, and you either have, there's the leading kind and the trailing kind. It's just a running count. So if these are the numbers 1 and 1, this is the running count, and this is the running prefix count. You can actually get either way. We don't penalize you if you like one direction versus the other. And I said, how in the world can you do that in parallel? It's a famous algorithm by Guy Blodick, famous to four people who do this sort of thing. I mostly wanted to talk about things so we do all that. Now people have the ability to do any old collection dot parallel stream dot any old filter map reduce. it's really easy to recode to take your serial functionally flavor fluent program, type in only 7 letters, and now have parallel versions. When should you do that? Now we have a mass education issue on our hands. You probably have a feel that it's not always easy to get a parallel speed up using even the nicest silk style divide and conquer portable parallel programming we know. If you, hopefully Danny mentioned it. The reason we like fork joints so much is the only parallel programming methodology that's portable that we know. If you know you're running on something that has a bunch of GPUs with, you know, so many hardware cores and things like that, you can write better code. But if you want to write something portable that runs on lots of platforms, adaptive divide and conquer is the only game we know. So we push it hard. And then we foist it on our users too, because now they have to get a feel for what's up here. So when there started becoming shrieks of disappointment out in the real world, and there are shrieks of disappointment out in the real world, there are people who say, wow, just never use this stuff, it sucks. And yeah, to them, it sucks. They shouldn't use it. Last spring, I threw this together, and it sort of sat and languished, and it's still in a sit in language mode. I think it's going to be put into the Java API guide for Perl Streams as something and formatted more nicely sometime soon. Has anyone seen this?
Yeah, we saw it yesterday. Gustavo found it and sent it to the whole class right after the after we did the lab with Perl Streams.
So. Oh, yeah, yeah. Perfect.
But I don't think that people, I don't know if others have.
Okay,
so I looked at it because while you were programming with Perl Streams,
yeah.
I looked over that because Gustavo
was good. Good. Well, you're prepped to hear me talk about it.
Then. Yeah.
When should you use Perl Streams? My attitude about this is this is really the same question I ask, when should I use a linked list versus a hash map? It's no different. If I'm just throwing a few things in, maybe a linked list is fine. If I want to find things quickly, maybe I want to use some hash set, hash maps, hash something. And okay, I'll use a little bit more time and space in getting things in, but I can get them out faster, I can do everything better. It's exactly the question. Coming to haunt people from this scary venue of parallel or not parallel, it's just like, in many, many more ways than one, just like linked lists versus arrays. Revisit. Can you randomly, so why do we urge people to use arrays and concurrent hash maps? Because they're randomly accessible. We can do very fast splits. And those are the only data structures for which that's true, pretty much. In fact, some background in history, I was adamant, strongly opposed to anything but, how about we have a version of Perl Streams for ArrayList and concurrent hash map. Claim success. Move on. And everyone, I think for good reason, I gave in and said, that's so not nice to our users. We want to have this sort of functionally flavored streams that can apply to all of them. Why should you only have parallel forms for the ones that happen to work well? So now we have to explain to people carefully when they ought to do things. And
But in practice, then they end up using streams over arrays.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you know, it's not for nothing.
Yeah.
Those are the two most common classes in usage in Java. It's sort of too bad. You know, one of the things I feel a little bit of failure about is that concurrent hash map is about between 15 and 20% slower currently than hash map in non-concurrent use. If it were 8%, we'd throw away hash map. It's right on that cusp. And the version 8 one is really pushed very hard because knowing this was coming, my thought was, you know, let's not even tell people. Let's just, all the parallel stream stuff, use concurrent hash map whenever they say hash map. Who would know? All right, so what do you have to know? You have to know something about each of these bold-faced things. You have some function. Maybe you're mapping x to x plus 1, y to x plus y. Maybe you're mapping x is the state of my chessboard, and I'm mapping that into the next best move. Right? So maybe I'm doing something that takes a nanosecond, and maybe I'm doing something that takes hours. To parallelize something that takes hours is really easy, because the overhead just doesn't even if you're parallelizing something that just takes a nanosecond, then you have to start thinking about, well, was it a good idea or a bad idea to try to use parallelism here? You have to know something about the function, something about the source, as I said. Array-based things are good to parallelize. Hash tables are hashed arrays, right? So arrays, parallel, everything else, not so much. Tree maps, not so bad. Concurrent skip lists, actually pretty good. Happy coincidence. So you know that, and then you say, well, okay, how many elements do I have? It's probably the easiest way to figure out, because if you're doing practically nothing, then you have to get past some threshold that says, is it worth parallelizing? Because not so much the overhead itself, but remember that was my remarks about how long does it take to unblock a thread? Remember, it has no answer anymore. Oops. So people are going to see huge variation. And they do. When they're parallelizing very small things, they get a lot of variation. And so to tell people something, if you sort of just do a bunch of these across the different machines, including on Android boxes and the like, just to get ARMs and like really, really, really not so great processors covered. 100 microseconds is a good number. It's too bad that that's not a number that means anything to anybody, right? It's not a memorable number, but it's actually a great number. If you had to like have one rule of thumb, parallelize or not, if the sequential version takes less than 100 microseconds, don't bother. So it's not really the scalability so much as the raw upfront. Is it going to take too long to get everybody going? So this is the wise. There's a startup effect, which I said. We work really hard on startup effects. One of the really fun things we do with the Perl framework is Spring Perl framework. There's functionpool.commonpool. There's a common default pool where all your Spring Perl stuff goes, travel sorts, things like that. When you submit to the common pool, even if you're not a Fortran worker thread, you start helping process that task while you wait for them to wake up. Really delicate to do and very effective. It cut all of those times by a very noticeable amount. You know, rule of thumb of 1,000 to 100 microseconds. But, you know, you need a few more factors than 10 before people can just not think about it whatsoever. Granularity, you know, if you only have 8 things and you have 64 cores, we can't give you a 64-way speed up if you're only doing 8 things. And so that problem, that sense of it is sort of obvious. The less obvious part is that some collections cannot split all the way down, including a current hash map. It does not split bins. Find as it goes in the collision bin. So if you're very unlucky, you'll get uneven performance. You're not usually that unlucky. Some link list is so terrible. Link list, you can run it in parallel. What does it do? It shoves all the elements of the list in batches starting at size 1,000. Not my decision. This was we've got to do something. And I said, well, there's an algorithmic answer, and that is that you start with size 1 and you increment that batch size by 1, and that will give you optimal performance for an unbounded stream. That's actually a fact that's been known for a while. And they said, thanks, Doug, we're going to start at 1,000. Why? Because when you do add 1 to each of my million elements on a linked list, the performance is a slowdown of a factor of a million. Terrible. Yeah. We get some. Remember, you don't get 10%, right? You get factors of 10. You can get some really impressive slowdowns adding up.
Something to try.
All right. So, why don't we just say, hey, don't worry, your pretty little head, we'll figure it out for you. Well, hopefully you got a feel for that, right? You can't figure it out all the time, right? You have to do some trial and error, and you have been sitting here bombarded by people talking about concurrency for a few days straight. VMs cannot figure this out themselves. There's a very sad history of automatic parallelism that dates back for 20, 30 years. The safest thing is we will automate it only if you let us. Just say yes, no. Just say parallel, not parallel. We will do as much from there. There's a second part that's a little bit that is a fun side API. There's only yes or no for the streams API. Concurrent hash map itself has versions of all these methods that take a parallelism threshold, and you can tune it only for that class. And that is entirely, so all the people doing big data analytics can tune their code. And there's a lot of people doing big data analytics, and all of them are using concurrent hash. For nobody else was it considered good enough idea to have tuning thresholds. There is standard recommended advice. What if I don't know? Well, this is what I was saying before. If you don't know whether you use parallel, well, it means you just have to grow up a little bit. Either you know or somebody else knows. So either make the decision internally using whatever code you like. We actually make stream versus parallel stream very simple to code for. So you can internally say, do I have enough stuff to go in parallel? And if so, go to the parallel. It could be that, you know, maybe if this is something a special data structure that's caching stuff from disk, then you'd use a different criterion. The idea is, yes, no, you decide. It's really easy. You write it. We can't. In the same way, linked list, array list, hash table. What should I use? Well, no, we're not going to make that decision for you. If you want people to dictate your data structures, use Python. What if I might block a lot of threads? Right, that's what question three is, a disguise. What if I might block all my threads? And we say, don't do that. We tell them, don't do that. You know we can secretly cope except for this. Well, in the extreme, we run out of threads. What if you want to do custom I/O into parallel streams? Then you wait for JDK 9. Or you figure it out yourself. It's not all that hard. But what we want is completable futures, remember them. Async I/O, probably didn't talk about that. Parallel streams. All you need is a bunch of semi-smart infrastructure to unite those, and now you can do asynchronous I/O collected into parallel data processing, and now you too can be the next famous big data star. Almost not a joke. Hexdata, my friends Click et al., they have a cluster-based big data engine, H2O, and it's worked on the inside and completion-based, highly structured I/O on the outside, and they blow away the competition. It's not hard to get just really good results. What if you're on a big overcommitted machine? This is actually a question that comes up fairly often. You're running on a cloud, and these cloud people, they're wisening up. They're saying, we can overcommit this to run you and 40 other people on this little tiny 2-core box. They do that too. Well, first, you should get your money back. But second,
it's not too late.
Yeah, the basic answer is, so long as you are not just thrashing to death, so as long as you're doing something other than context switching, it should not hurt too much. So don't worry about it. If it does hurt, then we have a way a sysadmin can actually disable parallelism. And so parallel actually just uses a zero worker thread pool, where you know that wake up the others and start doing it yourself while they wake up. Well, they never wake up. You still run. So for EE systems, we expect that people will disable it unless they're more enlightened than most of the administrators seem to be. Do we magically parallelize everything? Well, yes and no. If you're smart, you can beat us every time. We push general purpose collections through general purpose algorithms on general purpose computers. Most likely, if your life depended on it, you could probably do better for a particular data collection of data, a particular algorithm on a particular machine. The great thing about portable parallel programming is we can give you quite a lot for not much work. It sure beats the battle. Lived through a lot. MPI. There that ends. There are people saying this is not Java. They ruined Java. They broke my Java.
They can still use Java 1.2.
Not hitting up Corbin. Yeah, there's a guy who does some consulting training who's actually making a living telling people this is too scary and they should do something else.
Wow.
Yeah, you can find it without looking too hard. All right, so there's a lot of parallel concurrency support in JDK. It was a big refresh. JDK 5, from 5 to 6 to 7, really had that much that was very visible. And it was this confluence of forces. Lambdas, function types, ubiquitous multicores, a better understanding of the audience of our components, people like Danny were telling us what bugs people commit all the time. Lots. I actually have the most lines of code, new lines of code of anyone even outside of Oracle or JDK 8. For 9, what are we doing? 9 plus. First thing we're doing. You guys talked a little bit about memory models and volatiles?
No.
Oh, good.
Remember, you only started this Friday at 1 o'clock in the afternoon, so.
Okay. Well, that's actually good. I will, I'll give you the pep talk. The memory models are really hard to get right. Mm. They're all broken. They're broken in ways that don't affect you as a programmer, one little iota. But they're broken. They're broken in that they will say that a particular compiler optimization is illegal when we know it's not. Or they will say that a particular read can out of thin air get the value of 42 when we know it can't. The formalisms are very hard and have a long history and really extra smart people working extra hard to do it. It's very hard territory. The original Java memory model in JLS1 got it wrong, JSR133 got it wrong, the C++11 people got it wrong, C14 still have it wrong. We're not going to get it so wrong. All these memory models across languages, they leapfrog, and a lot of the same people are involved. People realize none of these things started off having known errors. Which is that? Is that over time, out that there are anomalies that the formal models allow, which are either too permissive or too restrictive. I'll show you a little bit about mine in a minute. So we're working on that. We're also working on getting full consistency across C++, Java on their interpretation of not only plain locks and volatiles, but also weaker modes and atomic updates and things like that. We would like to have the languages agree on semantics. And that means that we actually are going to add some APIs to Java to make it clearly commensurate. Nothing really interesting. A few things useful. Another part, a lot of people have found that for their specialized purposes, they can get vastly better throughput for using a very specialized data transfer component, queue, deck, etc. I know that because I've actually written a paper or two on it and use something inside a Fortran pool, for example. We use a double ending queue, a deck, that you cannot get outside of that class. You cannot use one because we can't express its API using Java collection Z's. It's one of these where it's got 3 of the 4 possible methods and a usage restriction that there's a single producer, multiple consumer. Well, there's a lot of cases like that. And we're tired of people saying, I'm going to build my own, and then getting it wrong, and then posting 35 messages about why it's wrong on the concurrency interest list. We would just like to supply the world with some of these specialized algorithms, maybe not even inside of Java util concurrent. Maybe it'll just be a side project of, here's some stuff that doesn't have all obey a clean API. single producer, multiple consumer, push, offer, put, pull, take. So the three methods. That turns out to be what you want for work doing. You don't want anything else. If you had to supply everything else, it would be slower. By a lot. Why do we do these tricky things in science code? Well, we just eat our own dog food. So we're going to probably do that. Minor JVM stuff, we're hoping for major VM stuff that's concurrency related. We've been hoping for a long time. Things that don't look like they're concurrency related. We would love to have tail call stack frame reads. This is tail recursion removal generally. And if you do that, you can have lightweight continuations without blowing stacks. We actually have a few cases where there's APIs we cannot put out, because if you were to use them, they'd infinitely recurse and never return. By intention, for good reasons. It's intentional infinite tail recursion, and it will blow stacks. We really need a fix for that. Be able to offer you to be able to program some of those things. Similarly for extruding a stack frame or two and handing it as an object. All those have been on wish list for ages. They're not going to happen soon because two really, really useful things for concurrency are preoccupying everybody's minds. Neither of those were going to happen for JDK 9. I think they're 10. Value types. Yay, finally. Why should you value types? It's not like function. You don't have to love functional programming to love value types. If you just like memory locality, you love value types. If something of a value type has no independent identity, you can shove lots of them in, embedded in the same object. Get rid of pointers chasing everywhere. Get rid of all of your data is randomly assembled. So there's actually two arms of this. Valhalla is value types. It's basically, if you know Scala value types, you pretty much know the story. And the idea is, don't just do what Scala did, put it in the VM. You know, if you're not aware of this, what is Scala's main purpose in the universe?
To give people to use Haskell.
No, it's the canary for Java, right? It's like, oh yeah, we went there and nobody died. I guess we could probably do that at the VM level. My entire life is dealing with languages that run on JVM. The Java APIs are the way you express the stuff. But whenever we put stuff out, almost every time the first users are Scala programmers. Almost every time. Scala programmers are my best friends. my best debuggers. Scala, Clojure, JRuby, and they all use our stuff before the Java people eventually get it.
Paul Phillips is a good
book. I'm not going to say much about that. So Valhalla is value types on the VM, which means that there will be specialized generics. There will be an array list of int, lowercase int. No more let's make our own custom things. There are a bunch of these third-party things like Trove that are like somebody's idea of something that's sort of just like array list but works on ints but doesn't have quite the same API just because they were feeling cocky or something. That is a huge amount of work. It actually requires bytecodes, new bytecodes, because you have to, there's this notion of VPAC and VNPAC. Take these things, pack them up values, shove them in this location. It will not get done for Java 9, so they are no longer even saying when it will be released. But it is hugely good news for parallel programming. I'll just tell you rather than show you. The if you're sorting parallel sort, using parallel sort, and you're using parallel sort on 64 bits go-alongs, we have the prettiest speed-up graphs ever. They're really good. More data, more cores, more performance. Suppose you just put a capital L instead of a lowercase l on that long. No matter how many cores we throw at you, no matter how much data you have, we cap at like 20x. Factor 20 you think is good, but we're capping at 20x on machines with like 256 cores.
Because of boxing?
Because of memory locality, yeah. So boxing is merely overhead sequential. It is worse than that by a long shot in parallel. You have cores, they're operating on logically different segments of an array, say, but they're all pointers to pointing things pointing to who knows where. All you have is cache traffic. You max out at the rate of your memory subsystem.
Yeah.
Not the number of cores, the rate of your memory subsystem. And as I opened up this talk, we know that's pretty limited. You know, that was the problem with stamp lock. Memory systems cannot scale anything close to cores do. You need these things just to be able to do it. It means also, without value types, you have no hope ever of taking parallel streams and mapping them onto GPUs. Just no hope whatsoever. So this will also enable some related work wanting to do. Not clear if they'll ever actually do that. The arbitrary parallelism on GPU world is a world of miraculous results. If somebody finds a clever way to do, you know, prime factoring on you know, using the texture grid support instructions of a GPU, and then the world starts doing it. And then they start mining bitcoins with them. A little tricky to shove into your general purpose programming framework. I suspect that they'll always be sort of, if you have a problem well suited to it, well, don't use the general purpose APIs. Use something more special to what you're doing. Project Panama is the other side of that. It is. I have these bits on my disk or off the network. Here's how they're laid out. Please read them in that way. Don't objectify them, point them over different places. They have this layout. Use that layout, please. That is a small but very vocal group of people, the high-frequency traders and the like. They do that now by using byte buffers as pseudo-data structures, and they read everything to a byte buffer, they figure out where all the offsets are in their byte buffer, then they put a veneer on top of that, and now they have pseudo-objects living in byte buffers. It's just an awful thing. No human being would want to program that way, and so, in my mind, Project Panama, it should have happened like this point, there's a whole industry up there doing this.
Kurt Jefferdine gave a talk to Java 1 on that, kind of promoting it.
Yeah, it's just a terrible thing. The deja vu part of it is, people doing real-time Java had exactly the set of issues a decade ago. They came up with solutions that were entirely geared towards predictability versus performance. So they have good solutions, but they're costly. Nobody has ever gone the extra steps and saying, you know, we have these two cultures, we have these problems, let's find some common ground. A week ago, 6 days ago, I actually gave the keynote talk at JTRES, the Java real-time conference, pleading with people, saying, you know some things, and the high-frequency people know some things. It's really got to be a better solution out there than what either of you have done, which both suck. And it's true. Everyone admits, the high-frequency trader people, they say it sucks. The Java JT RTSJ scope memory, oh my god, sucky. Is there something better? Yeah. People are smart, they'll figure it out. All right. Do I want to give you the... Do I have 3 minutes?
Yeah.
Memory models. Let's start right there. You're a modern CPU. And somebody says equals A plus B times C plus B. How do you process that thing? Well, you don't sequentially do the A plus B and sequentially do the C plus D. You grab these instructions as fast as you can off the instruction stream. And when all their inputs are enabled, you trigger them, and then you go from there. That is instruction level parallelism, fork join programming. It's the same idea. It really is. So that's what every CPU does these days. Why wouldn't they? It's a good idea. Well, that's a good idea, so long as nobody spies on you and sees you cheating. Or demands something that they should never have believed in the first place. So if it's the sensible way to execute programs is dependency-based parallel DAG execution, what do you do about an arbitrary write? A write comes in as an instruction and says, please write one to that location. You say, well, as soon as I see that instruction, it's enabled, I can do it. Oops, what if that write one is releasing a lock? Then you can't do it until somebody wants you to do it. How do they tell you they want to do it? Following the memory model. The memory model is set of rules by which processors are required to believe you about ordering. Not just execute things whenever they're enabled, but if you say don't do this until that, then you must not do that. How does that get implemented? On x86, it's a fairly conservative approach. It's TSO. It says if we ever do something where you could conceivably catch us moving a load around a store, or a load around a load, we'll suppress it so you can't actually see it. We'll invalidate that speculation. All except the case where they can't do anything about it, and that is on store buffer snooping. They push on something on memory, it's waiting, the memory's busy, it's, the write is there, the memory says, I can't take it yet, and you want enough block. Well, if you need that value again, you cheat and you look at the value you just wrote, rather than the one that is ordered into the coherence framework. So in TSO, there's only one kind of fence that's actually needed, and that's the fence. offense you get after it falls outright. On arms and power, they take the opposite point of view, saying, you know, it's we're not going to do anything nice. The compiler absolutely has to tell us when you have to obey the dependencies. And if you don't tell us your code, it's just going to break. Both of them are completely valid approaches to building CPUs. The x86 and Spark strategy means that you can write fairly simple-minded compilers for multi-threading, and everything works. You don't have to think hard about where to put fences and stuff. The ARM and power strategy is, we'll give you better raw throughput, but you absolutely got to do this stuff or your code's broken. And then, of course, that brokenness is not the compiler's fault. It's your fault for not saying volatile. If you don't say volatile, then it doesn't know that really you meant it. Do this after that. And the hard thing, as I said, the hard thing is, all the bugs in memory models are right here. What can you even say about a program when it's broken? It's just among the hardest things people have ever been tempted to do is make a formal model that tells you that you will never read the value 42 out of thin air. Well, we can't actually do that. So how do these rules come out? They look like a little table. Like for a compiler writer, the compiler writer says, look at locks and volatiles only. You look up in the table what to do. You put in some fences. The fences not only have to be for the processor, but have to prevent you from doing it. The extended volatile stuff, enhanced volatiles that I mentioned, is things like CAS, Exchange, and that are all intrinsics on one or more processors. And the other thing is, you know, if you're into this ordering control and you know the fences cost, then maybe you would like to devise an algorithm that doesn't use so many fences. That's what we do. So there's a couple of these that say, you know, I could use a very lightweight or even no fence. So on x86, they publish Quire, actually requires no fences. Create once and use requires no fences on x86. That's great because that's what a final field does. Me whining about that. Quick examples. So this is actually how the word scaling deck works. Got an array of these slots. You push something, pushes. Which is inside of fork. Okay. Says set a state to something. There it is. Store release. It means order this write after other writes. Don't do anything else beyond that. It's the cheapest of all the fences that processors support. On x86, it's a no op because that's the fence that's always done. So, no atomics to push. Cool, huh? No volatiles, no atomics. It's really good because we got about a billion of these per second going on our big machines running parallel streams. And when something happens a billion times per second, it's worth this micro optimization. We do it. On the other side, we yeah, we use these techniques a lot, and we would like to have them better specified, we'd like to have them better APIs, and we would like to have maybe, you know, 2,000 people on the planet use them. No more, no less.
How many are now?
Oh, hundreds. Part of it is to do that with no overhead. Write and release. There's not a write and release in the normal API, so you actually got to use unsafe. And unsafe, it's really unsafe. It's a fun story, but I'm already running over time. All right, that's where we've been heading, where we're going a little bit.